say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Therefore, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves, and we're truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy upon us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Because of what Jesus Christ has done on the cross for you, he has become an atoning sacrifice for your sins. Be assured that your sins are forgiven through your faith in Jesus Christ. So Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. God rules over all the earth. O come, let us worship.
Speak. filled with your glory.
Would you join me in saying the Venite this morning? Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend a knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice. At this time, we'll have the scripture readings followed by the sermon.
Feels perfect. Other days it just ain't working. The good, the bad, the right, the wrong, and everything in between. Yo, it's crazy, amazing. We can turn our heart through the words we say. Mountains crumble with every syllable. Broken, live or die. So speak life. Other days my thoughts just fall apart. I do, I don't, I will, I won't. It's like I'm drowning in the deep. Well, it's crazy to imagine words from my lips as the arms of compassion. Mountains crumble with every syllable. Hope can live or die. So speak life. Rain when you speak life with the words you say. Raise your thoughts a little higher. Use your words to inspire. Joy will fall like rain when you speak life with the things you say. Lift your head a little higher. Spread the love like fire. Hope will fall like rain when you speak life with the words you say. So speak life.
Welcome. This is the part of the service where we reflect on the Word of God and we learn what it means to apply to our own lives. Sticks and stones can break my bones, but words will never hurt me.
Well, that's what I learned in elementary. But I've come to understand that it's just not true. Words hurt. And so here is what Barry Wade, a poet, says. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can also hurt me. Stones and sticks break only skin, while words are ghosts that haunt me. Slant and curve, the word sword falls, it pierces and sticks inside me. Bats and bricks may ache through bones, but words can mortify me. Pain from words has left its scar on mind and heart that's tender. Cuts and bruises have now healed. It's words that I remember. What we say, the words that we use, has the power to build or break. The question is, for Jesus, what motivates us to speak these words? Jesus says, the words that we speak are dependent on the condition of our hearts. Now, if we're all honest with ourselves, we know that none of us have a perfect heart. We're not all 100% good. And Jesus gets it, right? And he says, for within the human heart, evil intentions come. So what Jesus is going to suggest in our gospel this morning is a heart tune-up. If the heart is right, then the words that we speak will also be right. Last week, I talked about how to be church in a post-pandemic world. This morning, I want to talk to you about how to be a church that builds each other up using words that come from a heart that is in tune with God. Let's hear our gospel this morning, that which I'll be speaking from. It's from Mark chapter 7. Now, when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around him, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the traditions of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" And Jesus said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'The people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines.' You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human traditions." Then he called the crowd again. He said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand, there is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile. The things that come out are what defile a person. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come. Fornication, theft, murder, adultery, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly, all these things come from within, and they defile a person." The gospel of Christ. Praise to you, O Lord Jesus Christ. So I was a bit surprised at Jesus' reaction to the Pharisees, right? Now, what they say sounds pretty harmless. They're just asking a question. They're like, "Why don't you wash your hands before eating? That's what we all do." And Jesus responds to them by calling them hypocrites. Why does Jesus have such a harsh response? All right, let me tell you a story. When I was in elementary school here in Canada, I think grade 3, I wore a pink and white striped polo to shirt one day. And one of the kids in the school looked at me and he said, "Hey, nice shirt." And I said, "Well, thank you." And he kind of snickered after I said thanks. What I didn't realize for a few seconds was that he was making fun of me. It didn't take me long to feel small and insignificant. The words didn't really make sense to me because it sounded nice. "Hey, nice shirt." But it didn't correlate with what he actually intended to say. The biblical authors would say that he was speaking from an unclean heart. Even though the words that he spoke sounded polished and clean. They kill and they destroy because it comes from a rotten place. You see, in the same way, the Pharisees, when they ask Jesus and his disciples why they don't wash their hands, don't really care if Jesus washes his hands or not. They intend to convey the opposite of what they're saying. They're trying to discredit his ministry by pointing out a flaw of a religious teacher in front of everybody. He's breaking tradition. And they believe, well, he isn't one of them. So they're going to bully him and shame him and ridicule him. Even though their words were polished, their hearts were rotten. And God sees their hearts. And immediately he answers back, your hearts aren't clean. And you're talking about clean hands? Oh, you hypocrites. Do you not know that nothing outside of a person can defile them by going into them? Rather, it is what comes out of a person that defiles them. That's interesting, isn't it? See, this past week, I was reading online about apples that have wormholes. Did you know that if you find an apple with a wormhole, it does not mean that there is a worm inside the apple? It actually means that an insect laid an egg in the apple blossom. And sometime later, when the blossom becomes the actual apple, the worm hatched inside the heart of the apple, and it eats its way out. The worm doesn't work its way into the apple, it works its way out. The hole shows us what was there inside all along. You see, in the same way, Jesus says that sin doesn't work its way into our hearts, it works its way out of what is already in the heart. The Pharisees are speaking or putting out what is in their heart. Sin, deceit. And this happens to us too, right? Like, we're not going to say the Pharisees, oh, they're terrible, because it happens to us also. We say things intentionally to hurt other people. This could happen in the form of gossip. It could happen through sarcastic speech, and sometimes simply out of anger and frustrations, we want to say hurtful things because we want the other person to be hurt. We want them to feel bad. And Jesus tells us the words that we speak are an indication of the state of our heart. What we say reveals what's in our heart. And if our hearts are filled with evil intentions, then the words that come out will also cause harm. So then what's the solution? Is it just to say nice things? Well, let me tell you a story. Can I just change the way I speak, and then God will be happy with me? Let me tell you a story. It's from a pastor who bought a house with his family. He needed to anchor a bookshelf, right? He had to anchor a bookshelf into the wall. And so he has to drive in screws and nails so that it doesn't like lean forward. And then a few months goes on, and he notices a bit of orange on the side of his the wall. And he's like, oh, how did I miss this orange on the wall? So he just paints over it. A few months goes by, and this time the orange becomes a bit orangey brown. And he's like, oh, maybe I didn't put enough layers of coat. So he paints it one more time. He whitewashes it. And again, a few months later, the orange and the brown start to show up. Well, what he then realized was it wasn't something on the outside. There was a deeper problem. So he had to break down the wall. And he realized that as he had anchored the shelf into the wall, the screws and the nails had gone in to the drainage pipe from the bathroom upstairs. There was a deeper issue than what he saw on the outside. It was leaking. The same way, we can't just whitewash our words. We have to fix the root cause of why we speak in such ways. Why are we speaking sarcastically, hurtfully, out of anger and frustrations? Jesus says it's because something's off in our heart. In Bible times, the heart was the control center of the body. Think of it like an engine of a car, right? It controlled your will, your intentions, your desires, where you wanted to go and how you get there. If there's a malfunction in the engine, then nothing will work properly. It needs to be taken to the mechanic and tuned. In the same way, if we're harboring sin in our heart, then our intentions and our desires, where we want to go, how we want to say things, how we act in this world, will malfunction. And here's the thing. We can't fix an engine by ourselves. We take it to a professional, a mechanic. In the same way, we can't fix the heart by ourselves. We need to take it to a professional. And the only person that can fix our heart is God. And he'll get in there and he'll tune our hearts, the Bible says. God does the tuning, not us. Then no, what do I do, right? What can I do? One pastor says this: we can't change our hearts, but we can change our actions towards Jesus. And when we change our action towards Jesus, God will change our hearts. I want you to think of it like you're a musician, part of an orchestra, and God is the conductor. And as you turn to him, he will tune your hearts. So have you ever heard what an orchestra sounds like when they're trying to tune instruments themselves? Okay, let me just play a quick audio clip for you. Sounds terrible, right? There's so much noise. Different people are playing different things. And then this is a warm-up. No one's in tune. And once everything's a bit more settled, the conductor comes in, he taps, and he says, "All right, now everyone, give me a C." Then everyone plays the same note. You know, some are in tune, but then those that are not in tune, he can hear. Right? The conductor knows. And he'll point to that person. And he says, "Well, that is a little off." And he'll tell them, here's how you tune it, right? Or he'll help them tune. And the musician, what he has to do, he has to turn to the conductor and listen to what he says. And then the conductor, will tune the instrument through the musician. As the musician turns towards the conductor tunes the musician's instrument through the musician. In the same way, as we turn to God, he turns to us and he tunes our heart through what we do. But our turning to God is a response to an invitation from God to be a part of something much bigger. If the musician's like, "You know what? I'm not going to tune my instrument. I'm just going to keep playing whatever I want to play." What's the conductor going to do? Leave. Get out. If you're not going to be part of this big thing that we're trying to create here, then what's going on? But as we listen to God, the conductor of our lives, the tuner of our hearts, he invites us into a much bigger plan, to be a church, to be part of the melody that the church makes. For a church to sound right, we need to be aligned with the conductor, God, who will tune our hearts. But we have to surrender to his will. We have to turn our actions towards God. So I'll end my sermon this morning by saying this. Well, how do we become a church that builds each other up by using words that come from a heart that is in tune with God? Well, one, we surrender ourselves to God. We move towards God and say, "God, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. Do with it what you will." We give the keys of our control center to our mechanic, to Jesus. That is our action. And as we surrender daily to the will of God, this is prayer that I would like you to pray. It's an easy 7-word prayer. And I know I've said this before. Lord, let my will be aligned with yours. Lord, let my will be aligned with yours. 2, we begin to see ourselves as part of something much bigger, a part of God's grand purpose and plan in this world to inaugurate his kingdom. Then we will start to be one with each other in the church. We will start to function as the body of Christ. Each instrument, although it makes a different sound, will come together and make one beautiful song. Did you know that the word members, you're all members of the body of Christ, is also the same word which could mean a musical note. You're all a musical note in the melody, in the orchestra of God's kingdom. And finally, when we're one with God and we're one with each other, when we surrender to God's will and we're all playing in the same orchestra, we begin to see our strength in God as a community of believers. And what we'll do, and we're all going the same way, we're all playing the same song, we'll begin to encourage each other. We'll begin to speak hope, love, and joy into each other's lives as we live as community. We begin to use words that build up because all our interests are aligned. You see, when we as a church come together in unity, according to God's will, with each other, our hearts are tuned to God. And when our hearts are tuned to God, the words that we use begin to be conformed to the likeness of his Son. We begin to build up. God fixes and tunes our hearts. The words that we speak become words that build. So my encouragement to you today is this. Surrender your will to God. Allow him to tune your hearts. Let the words that you speak bring life to the community that you're part of. Let your actions be turned towards God. Build up. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we pray that you would change our hearts from the inside out. That we would be a people that builds your community, the kingdom of God, together through what we do here. Let your will and work be done. That our words be words that bring joy, hope, peace, and love in this community as we strive to be a church that lives according to your will as members of one community. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, and all of God's children said, amen. God bless you. I'll see you soon.
Our service continues with the affirmation of our faith. This is what we believe. Together we say the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. At this time, would you join us in praying for our churches and our communities?
With confidence in God's constant care, we place our needs before him, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we walk in God's loving care, we pray that he will guide us and our churches in these challenging times, that all clergy receive God's strength to persevere with the needs of their parishes and their communities. For the parishioners of St. John's and St. Albans, as we reach out to spread the word of our Lord while providing guidance and support to all those we encounter, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our nation and for all nations, and we pray especially for the nation of Afghanistan. We pray with God's help they will meet their new challenges and return to the peaceful nation that they had become. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all our families and friends, we pray God's blessing upon them today, especially those most in need of God's assistance at this moment. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks, O God, for the gifts of health and material blessings that you have given to us. We pray for those who do not have these gifts, that you will aid them and guide them, that we might mutually support them in their hour of need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember the loved ones of those who have gone before us, and may God grant them eternal rest and life in his presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are sick or recovering in hospital, and for all the families who are suffering and grieve a loss. And we pray that you will pass your comfort over onto them in their moments of suffering. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We rise in thanks and praise to you, our Lord, for giving us your Son. We give you thanks for the forgiveness of sin, for his continued blessings upon us, and the continued comfort and peace that we receive for the prayers answered and unanswered by you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And gracious Father in heaven, you have accepted us as your children, that we will enter heaven despite the sins against us. Hear our prayer that we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. May the blessing of God the Father continue to be with you. May the blessing of God the Son, who went to the cross for us, continue to bless your lives. May the blessing of the Holy Spirit, who sustains you and who sanctifies you, bless you and keep you. May the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit keep you now in this life and the life to come, forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. I'll see you all next week.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. You pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes. at a loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's over.